Hi guys, my name is Bong. Today I'm here with Pinot and we are work for Delicate Gibbons. And actually we've been working for our clients on the PDPA project in various industries, and we work ever since the law is just a draft, and now there is a development on the law. You may see in the public hearings that there are some draft subordinated regulations which to be issued in the future. So this is the great opportunities that today we'll be talking about it. And before we going through all the topics under the group ones of the subordinated regulations, we will give you an overview of the hearings. So the hearings will include 8 sections. We will show you all the sections in the below link, and we will focus on the first part of the subordinated regulation, which is the consent requirements. So could not will be demonstrated on the details of the consent requirement under the subordinated regulations. So please, could not.
Thank you. Actually, before we go to the consent requirement, I think it would be worthwhile for all of us to understand first why we need sub-regulation. Just so you know, right, the Personal Data Protection Act, which in short we call it PDPA, it has been enacted since 2019 with the grace period of 1 plus 1 year, that's 2 years. And then the PDPA itself, it carries a lot of principles, which all of them, most of them has been adopted from the GDPR principle. But the law itself, it just carry out the key principle, but it does not really tell us what are the details or what are the actual thing that the businesses need to do in order to comply with the PDPA. So what's very essential for the PDPA to be able to ask for all of us to comply in practice is the sub-regulations. So that is why we think that the sub-regulations are very important, and for you all to really need to understand what are the key requirements and how do people will be able to interpret the requirement under the PDPA. So before we talk about the consent requirements, which has been discussed at the at the public hearing session one, why not Bong talk a little bit about what are the key requirements of the consent under section 19?
Okay, Kap, for the overview of the consent requirements, it's stated in the section 19 of the PDPA. The general requirement is that consent must be obtained before or at the time of the collections of the personal data, and it must be clearly specified, informed, and must not be ambiguous. And of course, it cannot be hardly to understand, so you need to have the simple wordings that the data subject may understand on the top contents of the consents. And under the section 19, they give the room for the PDPCs to issue the subordinate regulations regarding the contents and the form of the consents. So that's why we will talk about the details on the consent, so that could not be present on this.
Sure. Thank you. Actually, at the public hearing, right, one of the most important draft regulation in this first set is the consent requirement. Just so you know, first at the public hearing, the regulator didn't say that they are going to issue more regulations that are going to give more conditions on the consent requirements. So the conditions and the requirements on the consent, in principle, remain the same as what Khun Bong has mentioned. But what the PDPC is thinking is to maybe issue what is called a negative list, which actually is a list that contain the type of consent and also type of consent requirements that are not valid under the PDPA. Like for example, if the request for consent is too broad, then that is something that would not be acceptable under the PDPA. And intentions of this negative list is to just tell the business what are the don'ts that they cannot do, and then so they have the liberty or the freedom to design on how they would want to collect the consents or the way or even the contents that they would want and need to collect consent that will fit with the way that they do business. So negative list is just a framework. That's something that you need to be mindful that you don't fall into that pitfall, or otherwise the consent language and the requirements or even the approach can be up to the decisions of the business operator. And another interesting thing that the PDPC has mentioned during the public hearing is about what is called binding form and non-binding form. Have you heard about it?
Yes, I have heard about it, and I thought it's very interesting for the business operator to follow. So the binding forms, based on my understandings, is something like issued by the specific regulators that maybe have an effect on the binding on the operators that to be have to be followed. So it's really different from the non-binding forms. The non-binding form is something like a guideline for the business operator to follow, but it's recommended by the PDPCs. So it may help the business operators to have like clear on what the process should be taken.
Yes, it's like a navigation for the businesses to be mindful on the language and everything, right? So in the in the public hearing sessions, actually the regulator has mentioned about maybe coming up with what is called binding forms, which all those forms are actually from the collaboration between the sector-specific regulators. Like for example, financial services, it will be the Bank of Thailand, and also perhaps the financial institutions within the industry working together with the PDPC to come up with the binding forms that will be published by the PDPC so that the financial institution will be able to use as a standard form and for the customer to be able to rely upon that these standard forms are acceptable under the PDPA and also to the public as well. As opposed to what Khun Bong has mentioned about non-binding form, the PDPC also talk about the initiative that the associations or the business industries, they can actually gather or group together and come up with the non-binding forms. It will be like the recommended one and then can also seek formal consultation with the PDPC to recognize that binding forms for their specific industry. So that is quite interesting. But because both of us have actually attended each sections of the sub-law hearing, right? And for me, I'm going to give some of my thoughts about what I heard. That's actually for the first sessions for financial services. Actually, there's the business said quite being comfortable with having the concept of binding form and non-binding form. I think it is because the corporations under supervision are quite a number, and then it's because the nature of the business is quite regulated. So they are very welcome to the concept of the binding form and non-binding form. But as opposed to the sections that I was invited to join, which is the sessions that that was focused on technologies and e-commerce, well, the businesses in that sector are not so welcome and still have some hesitation about the concept of having binding form or non-binding form. It is just because when they're transacting online, right, through the website, to the application or to the platform, if you have the consent form that is not in a paper-based format, you would want something that you will be able to play around and that will fit well with the type or with the platform or with the web base of those business operators. So on technologies, business side, maybe not so welcome on the concept of having two tangible and rigid binding and non-binding forms. What about the session that you have attended?
Yes, for the life science sectors, it's quite follow the rules of the specific regulators, which is the Ministry of Health. So I think there will be some kind of the binding form that the business operators in that sector need to be followed. So Khun Nopka, please correct me if I'm wrong. Do I understand correctly that some association in Thailand is already conduct the binding forms? You have heard about it?
Yes. Good point as well. Actually, especially for the financial services that we are very much involved, we understand that for the banking association, they have formed up and together working with the Bank of Thailand and also the MDES to come up with the industry guideline for compliance with the PDPA. Also, within that guideline, is also have some of the consent form and everything. And for us, we are very fortunate to be able to assist the insurance associations, both life and non-life, to be the drafter of the of the guideline for compliance with the PDPA, and then we will also help them on the process of consultation with the insurance regulator and also with the PDPC, and within that guideline, which to be honest quite thick, there's also a consent form as well. So yes, we have seen quite a number of initiatives that's going to have the towards the consent form, the binding consent form. And another thing that I would also like to add is because the Ministry of Health, also yes. by FDA, they have just come up with the consent form for the pharma sector. Yes. So we think that actually that form will in the future be adopted and maybe be taken in considerations for especially the consent form for the industry of life science.
So this is all for today's. We hope you guys like it, and for the next clip, we will discuss all the topics of the notification requirements. So please stay tuned on more clips. Thank you.
Thank you.